During the Revolutionary War, many slaves became loyalists after being promised their freedom in exchange for fighting for the crown. The Earl of Dunmore, who was also the governor of Virginia, made a proclamation that any slave that was willing to fight for the British would be freed after the war. Anywhere from 800 to 2,000 slaves joined what would be called Dunmore's Ethiopian Regiment. The only notable battle in which Dunmore's regiment participated was the Battle of Great Bridge early in the December of 1775, where the British were defeated. Although losing the battle stifled Dunmore's progress as a defender of the crown, disease would be the regiment's undoing. Smallpox ruined the British plan to raise an army of slave and indentured servants by promising them freedom after the war. The disease killed off most of the Ethiopian regiment, even as it assembled. Despite this failure, there were successful black regiments, including the Black Pioneers, who were generally used to build fortifications in battle, and the Black Brigade, who fought through New Jersey and brought supplies to New York. But eventually the British wanted to try a different tactic. The British knew that if slaves fled the South's economy would crumble, and the colonists would not be able to pay for the war. So the British moved towards economic warfare. To expedite the slaves abandoning plantations, Sir Henry Clinton, a British Army officer, issued a proclamation in 1779 called the Philipsburg Proclamation. The Philipsburg Proclamation expanded on Dunmore's proclamation, saying that any slave who flees their plantation will be freed by the British after the war, regardless of whether or not they fought for the crown. The plan was successful. In fact, it was too successful. So many slaves escaped that they left the southern economy in ruins and much of the black population without food. As a result, Clinton ordered many runaway slaves to return to their masters. Despite their successes, the British would eventually lose the Revolutionary War, and the fate of the black loyalists would become a debated topic, which is where the Book of Negroes comes into history. The Book of Negroes was the result of a dispute in 1783 between the Commander-in-Chief of the Continental Army, George Washington, and his British counterpart, Sir Guy Carleton. Washington demanded that the British hand over black slaves who fought on the Loyalist side because it was required by Article 7 of the Treaty of Paris. Contrary to what most people thought, the Philipsburg Proclamation said only slaves fleeing the American rebels would be accepted into the British military service as freedmen. Carleton stretched its words by saying that the British promised all slaves freedom. Despite claiming that all slaves were freed, Carleton agreed, under Washington's pressure, to record each black loyalist who traveled by British ships to Nova Scotia, creating the Book of Negroes. He did this to show Washington that all the people recorded were freed by the British. This book lists each person's name, age, former slave owner, body description, and other information that would be useful if a dispute ever arose for the slaves to be returned. For example, Henry was a 47-year-old man and a stout man whose former slave owner was Thomas Marin of Old Fairfield. Many loyalists looked to ensure the freedom of the men and women within this book through freedom certificates and found ways to ship these former slaves to Canada and in some cases Britain, where they would find refuge from slavery. By 1784, many black loyalists had made their way to Nova Scotia with an evacuation fleet towards a brighter, safer future. But the promises of freedom on the horizon of the Canadian sun soon gave way to the prejudice of the whites. Seen as a burden on the already overpopulated town of Halifax, the blacks were sent to make their own town 3 miles away. They would name this town Birchtown, after Brigadier General Samuel Birch, who signed the majority of the freedom certificates that freed slaves in the state of New York. To make building a town increasingly difficult, these freed blacks were not given tools, livestock, or food, and sometimes had to resort to indentured servitude to find shelter and food during the harsh winters of Nova Scotia. An Englishman named William Dott visited Birchtown and described the black loyalist town as beyond description wretched, and also said that he had never seen such wretchedness and poverty so strongly perceptible in the human species as these outcasts. As they continued to live in poverty and cause strain to the crown, an idea of moving these freed slaves to Africa came about. In 1787, the Sierra Leone Company, which was funded by the crown, helped move the freed slaves in Canada and Britain who had fallen into poverty to a new colony in Africa. By 1808, this colony had gone through so much internal turmoil that the British government had to buy it back and claim it as a royal colony. Although these men and women did not fare well in the time after they were freed, their freedom set a new precedent for the future arguments against slavery. By allowing slaves to be freed, it humanized them and allowed for an emancipationist viewpoint to arise in a predominantly pro-slavery country.
Cure ourselves of slavery. This amendment is that cure.